Hello, everyone. Welcome back after lunch. We've got a really fantastic and exciting panel ahead of us with the theme of predicting November. I'm going to be introducing the speakers. My name's Alex. I'm a junior studying computer science in the college. We have several speakers here today. We have Nate Silver, the founder and editor-in-chief of 538, well known for bringing the science of statistics and forecasting to the public. And we have Clare Malone, a senior political writer for 538 as well. We have David Rothschild, an economist at Microsoft and fellow at the Applied Statistics Center at Columbia, who looks at user engagement with data and polling in particular. We have Nate Cohn, writer for the Upshot of the New York Times, and looking at polling and demographics in particular there. And we have as our moderator, Anthony Salvanto, who is the director of elections for CBS News. Thank you very much, and I hope you give them a very warm welcome here.
Thank you all for coming. And thank you, Ryan, thank you, Kirk, for organizing this. This has been a lot of fun so far. We hope to continue in that. I'm sure when you set this up as a predicting November panel, you predicted that by now we would know what November would look like and who the nominees would be. So that's one prediction that fell a little short. But there have been others. And to pick up a little bit on where the last panel left off when they were talking about the primaries, you know, it struck me and it struck some of us over lunch that maybe we've been using the wrong metrics all along, or at least as they apply to this year. So a year ago, a year and a half ago, when some folks on this panel, not that we'll name anyone, all thought that, you know, Donald Trump had no chance and this wouldn't, you know, there wasn't going to be much of a run for him. You know, were we measuring the right things? So far, what we've seen in, let's pick up on Donald Trump support, we have seen it cuts across ideology. It doesn't really fit into any neat demographic boxes. Yes, there's a split a little bit more pronounced among non-college than college, but it's not entirely predictive. It seems very attitudinal. Obviously, it used to support on immigration and some other policy positions, but again, not perfectly predictive. So what have we learned coming out of this primary process that will make us better at predicting November? Nate, how do we make predicting great again?
Well, let me say one thing, which is that Donald Trump hasn't won the nomination yet, and it's pretty tenuous whether he will or not. If you go to betting markets right now, it's about 55% chance for Trump and a 45% for everyone else. That would obviously have to involve a contested or brokered convention of some kind. So there's the risk of, you know, getting way ahead of ourselves back in the summer and saying, well, usually candidates like this don't come close to winning party nominations. Therefore, sooner or later, something will happen. But there's also a risk of getting ahead of ourselves now and forgetting that Donald Trump could very easily be denied the nomination because people in his party don't want him to get it in a kind of screwed up way that would validate some of the party decides thesis in a very literal way. The delegates decide, I guess, that no, we don't want you to represent us, even though you have the plurality, not the majority of support. But that's just a preamble to say that I think any lessons that you take from Donald Trump, this is true anytime that you have a sample size of one, there should be lessons that are true in a sense, whether or not he winds up winning. You know, I think one lesson is frankly just a lesson about sample sizes, that if you have a sample of 15 past elections since 1972 when you had the McGovern-Frazier reforms, then figuring out, you know, 0 out of 15 is not that impossible. Strange things will occur, and no matter how much you kind of massage the evidence and persuade yourself that, oh, this thing can't happen, well, you're dealing with a small sample size. It's not like sports or something. It's not even like elections to Congress where you have hundreds every year where strange things can happen in presidential nomination processes. But you did mention earlier how the groups that Trump appeals to are groups that we would have had trouble identifying certainly before the election, why Trump did so well in states including Massachusetts, Alabama, and Hawaii. Not the typical combination of the red-blue map that we're used to. And I think some of the lessons are sort of, well, there were all these trends that were existent for a long time, including greater polarization, greater distrust between voters and the media. You know, the Republican Party having a lot of near misses of disastrous outcomes. So we kind of thought all 4 years ago, oh, Herman Cain, he's kind of a joke, and he faded, and this proves that the stronger, more traditional candidate will win in the end. Well, it could mean there were a lot of near misses. Certainly the number of government shutdowns, the number of brinksmanship over the debt ceiling, the speakership transition, the fact that the Republican Party has become an unempirical party in a lot of ways. All those things are warning signs, and I think someone, people have made the comparison between the Trump nomination and the financial crisis, where on the one hand, the system's pretty robust, and a lot of things have to go wrong for it to occur. On the other hand, you know, they're sort of all things we should have known about. I think we should have known about the fact that racism is still a very prominent part of the country, and that's a significant minority, but a significant part of Trump's vote nevertheless. When you've seen him go up in the polls is when he demonizes Mexicans or Muslims or some other group. You know, I think, like I said, I think there were reasons to think the Republican Party was in somewhat of a state of disarray. The fact that you started out with 17 candidates running was very unusual, and I think should have probably led earlier on to more people scratching their heads and saying, wait, something has gone screwy here, right? But there are a lot of lessons for Trump. Anytime something unusual occurs, then usually it involves multiple things coming together, like a plane crash or something. It usually requires three or four things to go wrong. And also, it usually is a very close outcome. So, you know, when unlikely things occur, they usually occur barely. When a 15 seed beats number 2 seed in the NCAA tournament, then they just barely win or just barely lose. And so that's kind of consistent with this nomination where, you know, I think it's going to be really close whether Trump, number 1, gets 1,237 delegates, number 2, if he's a little bit short, how the delegates will decide to handle that case.
Yeah. And if he's a little bit shorter, he's a little bit over, then everybody goes and focuses on the rules committees and the credentials committees, et cetera.
I mean, it's, yeah. I mean, and you thought the primaries were fun, you know, wait for, you know, I mean, just the number of scenarios that can take place and the interlocking rules. And but basically, you know, the 1,237 people, or rather it's twice that many, the roughly 2,500 people who will be in Cleveland are people by and large who will not personally like Donald Trump. That's a big problem for Donald Trump, potentially. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, when we look ahead, he would need, if he doesn't win Wisconsin, and he, let's say he does win New York, then he still needs to pick up at least 60% of the remaining delegates, probably something closer to 2/3. The map is favorable to him, but to your earlier point, you're exactly right. He hasn't tied this thing up yet by any stretch. But the larger picture here, the fact that, you know, voters have clamored for what we have called an outsider, well, what exactly does that mean? The fact that we always go around saying, oh, voters are angry, they're angry at the process, they're angry at the system, what exactly does that mean? And are there enough of them everywhere that whoever the Republican nominee is, that can actually change the electoral map then come November? And Nate Cohn, you've looked at this a little bit in a recent piece where you talked about Trump's support in blue states. We heard a little bit from the last panel about the the sort of missing white voters, the ones who they described are supposedly conservative but not necessarily always participating in Republican primaries. You know, talk a little bit about that and whether you think those folks are actually out there and whether the electoral map could change in November, you know, give Trump as the nominee, Cruz as the nominee, whoever, whatever the scenario.
I think both halves of that are right. I think that there are a large number of people who are today are in the Republican Party who sort of ancestrally or demographically you would have expected to be Democrats, white Catholics in the Northeast, white Southerners, working class white voters more generally, who in 1960 would have been Democrats. Today are Republicans. They are more moderate on economic issues. They might well be motivated by racial animus. And today they are many of Mr. Trump's best supporters. But you know, the key thing there is that these are Republicans. These are people who are, for the most part, already people who considered themselves to be Republican-leaning voters. And the polls make it very clear that whatever support that Mr. Trump has among this group of Republicans who were once Democrats, it does not extend very far into the broader universe of independents who are white working class voters, for instance. I also don't think that there's a tremendous amount of evidence that there's a huge pool of populist, conservative, missing white voters. I think that in the battleground states, there are far fewer missing white voters than there are nationally, and most of the data, most of the analysis about the missing white voter phenomenon is done at the national level. I also think that when you look at voter registration files and you identify the people who voted in 2008 or 2004 but not 2012, you find that they are far likelier to be registered Democrats than Republicans. You find that they're far younger than all voters, which is something that also shows up in the census. And so to me, that suggests that the pool of missing white voters might mainly include young Democrats who were motivated by Bush in 2004 and Obama in 2008, and they stayed home with a Democratic incumbent present on the ballot. They look to me a lot more like Bernie Sanders or maybe Ron Paul supporters than they do supporters for Donald Trump, even if they were in large enough numbers to overcome whatever demographic advantage Hillary Clinton might come in with, given the extent that Donald Trump has alienated core Democratic-leaning constituencies.
And a lot of that has been talked about in the context of economic anxiety. And David, if you, you know, with an economics background, if you had told us a year or two ago that gas prices would be low, that unemployment would be down, that the stock market would be up, and yet voters would still be acting on supposedly great economic anxiety, right? That's got to be a surprise. Are those measures, are the traditional economic measures for how we gauge whether the economy is good or not, are those now out of date?
Well, traditionally, we look at a lot of these things, but when it comes to the modeling, what we see is really change in income that makes the difference. And when we see that the unemployment rate is going down or went up slightly, say, to 5.0, we see great jobs numbers month after month, but it's really the change in real income or change in even this case without inflation, nominal income, that makes the difference when it comes to forecasting elections. And here we've seen something that's somewhat middling. And so it's actually not that surprising that you're seeing it cutting both ways, because the perception of the change also is something that is quite bifurcated by party ID. And as Nate was hinting right before, despite the fact that we have extremely low numbers of people who are claiming that they're in one party or another, either by registration status or directly, what we see election after election is that people actually have more partisan standing than ever, that people are credibly set to one party or the other, and so they're getting very different views of what the economy is. And so when you have something that's in the middle, it's really easy to split it into both directions. And I want to add one more point to what Nate was saying before, Nate Silver was saying before, which is really key. We will never know the true underlying value of Donald Trump's probability of victory on July 1st or on April 1st. It's an unknown. And this is something that is going to be talked about forever, but there is a good chance that if God came down and gave us the true probability of Donald Trump winning on July 1st, it may have been approaching zero. Everything had to happen in a certain way, and that if we replayed this 100 times, he would win just once, conditional on him actually winning. And so this is a key thing to think. This is why we throw probabilities out there, because there's a probability of it going on the other side. Don't think in terms of binary. Think in terms of these probabilities, and things are going to happen.
But in that model is a variable that I think we have not fully specified or defined. And it is this, let me come back to this idea of voter anger, people's anger and frustration. We use those words, we think we know what they mean, but they're clearly having an effect here. It's just very hard to know exactly what it is. Claire, you wrote what I thought was a very interesting piece talking about Donald Trump's support and the anxieties that were behind it, but also the various ideas and theories of Trumpism, if you will. Yeah. You know, could you talk a little bit about, unpack that for us? What is anger? What is frustration right now?
Ooh, those are good existential questions. Yeah, so the piece I wrote was sort of came out of, I'd been traveling for a while, and the title of the piece sort of, you know, spills the beans. It's Why Trump, right? And a lot of it was me talking to a bunch of people. I think what really did it for me was I was talking to a couple at an Oklahoma rally for Bernie Sanders, and they talked to me for like 5 minutes about how great Bernie was, and then they said, but we love Donald Trump, and we'll probably end up voting for him. And to me, it was sort of like, well, what's going on here? And they were, you know, nice people, but a little angry. So the idea of like, what is angry? Where does that come from? Where is the anger being fed? I kind of started to look at You know, I come from a magazine background, so you're always trying to find what you call a donkey, someone to carry the story. And usually it's a person, so if you're writing a profile, it's a profile about the person, but it's also about a greater thing. And with Donald Trump, you know, it's a little bit of like an empty vessel donkey, because it's kind of hard to tell, you know, his thoughts are a little bit slippery. So the real interesting thing is like, well, where are his supporters coming from? And so I looked at, there's a lot of really interesting political science. For a while, people thought that Trump supporters were autocratic. And then there was, I kind of tend to think it's more of like a true populist thing. But there's a certain, there's sort of been studies that show that a lot of Americans distrust the mainstream media, you know, which is a big thing if you work in the mainstream media. So, you know, this is the Facebook election, right? Like, people are getting their news from places that you might find in your Facebook feed. It's a little bit of an echo chamber, and you get something from Free Republic, which is sort of like the Reddit of the right. It's a rumor that gets started, and you might not trust your news source. So that's one thing that I found is sort of amplifying Trump support to a certain extent. But more powerful, I think this is a really interesting election, partially because obviously this is an analytics conference, and this is a panel with a lot of stats guys on it. But it's also, there is something slippery happening where I think there is a bit of a, with Trump supporters, white, the Upshot had a really great mapping the geography of Trumpism, and it showed that counties that had deep Trump support had a lot of whites with just a high school education or high propensity of mobile homes. And there was sort of this idea that you would see in Trump rallies, and sort of there's a lot of dog whistling at those things. But there's a sense of, I sort of framed it in my piece as a reconstituted identity among a certain kind of white American. You know, Trump constantly refers back to the silent majority. And I think that's actually a really powerful thing for his campaign. These people are finally feeling like their problems are being listened to, you know? And I think that that's, people don't wanna feel, for lack of a better word, emasculated. Or, you know, John Kasich has sort of he's giving a little bit of a soothing balm to an angry electorate. People don't want that. They wanna feel empowered, and that's what Trump is giving them. So it's a little bit of, he's not just tapping into the anger, he's directing it in the person of Donald Trump. And he, you know, he had great name recognition, and well, we might have thought he was a little bit of a preposterous candidate. It kind of makes sense, especially with the American fascination with television. So,
what makes it so durable? In the sense that some of our metrics have always assumed that people change the way in which they evaluate a candidate as an election season goes along. Somebody mentioned earlier, well, we get closer to the election and people start thinking, well, do I see this person as a commander in chief? That was all applied to Trump on and on. And I can tell you from our polling and others that once somebody was a Trump supporter, they never moved. Even when we re-interviewed them again and again,
right,
they never moved, and they still don't. That's in part confounded the predictions. Nate, why has that been? What leads to the durability of that support, and then can he carry that over if he does become the nominee into November?
I mean, it's not that hard to be durable when you're getting a plurality of a plurality, and that's the thing I think is the most missed story of the election, which is that Donald Trump is profoundly unpopular. He is probably the most unpopular politician, if not the most unpopular person in America. But like, people are like, this is a big part of the story from day one. You know, he's relatively unpopular within the GOP. Obviously, has a pretty sizable plurality, 37% of the vote so far. And depending on how you count, roughly half, give or take, Republicans potentially would support him, see him as their nominee. Varies a lot from state to state. But you know, part of it is that at every stage of the process, Donald Trump doubles down on appealing to his base, and a base that, again, kind of defies doesn't easily categorize along traditional ideological lines, at the very least. Demographically, a little bit more. We know that there are people that generally have lower socioeconomic status. This is different from the Tea Party, but the Tea Party was actually a lot of people who were fairly well off. You know, the Trump supporters aren't, by and large. There was an interesting hypothesis, I haven't seen much test of it yet, but Michael Barone noticed that it seems like Trump does well with people where you have low degrees of social connectivity. where you're not that well integrated into your community. And that can apply, by the way, to why did Trump do so well with Republicans in Massachusetts here? Well, because there aren't very many of them. And if you're Republican in Massachusetts, and the way people now orient themselves implicitly and explicitly around political affiliations, you know, you might not have a good network in your community if you're a Republican in Massachusetts. You might feel a little bit estranged from it. And I think, you know, kind of Trump is kind of the champion of something. The people who are kind of feel like they're left out of the system, both kind of righteously, I suppose, if they have their job shipped away, but also people who, you know, who frankly are a little bit bigoted too. I mean, if we can't talk about that, we can't really have an honest conversation about Donald Trump.
Well, let's talk about that connectivity for a second. You know, in a social media world, all we ever hear about is people have never had more access to information. They've never been able to reach out as easily to people who are just like them. So how does that hypothesis hold up if these folks can be readily connected? And I think, Nate, you started to say something
I have no idea about the way that social media may lead people to feel more connected with people, or perhaps means that they just stay in their basements at their computers all day and actually don't have more meaningful interpersonal interaction. But I do think that there is something really important that comes out when you look at the demographics and the geography of his support. And, you know, Nate mentioned that it's interesting that you have a candidate who's done very well in places like Alabama, Massachusetts, and Mississippi. And they're not states that you often see together, but you did see them together a lot in the middle part of the 20th century. These were all places where Democrats did very well at the height of the New Deal coalition. And when you look at the geography of racism in America, you see a strong, whether it's measured by the implicit association test or whether it's Google search data on how often people search for racially charged words like the N-word, you see this same pattern again of the southern United States and the industrial North. And these places have a lot in common historically in that they were strongly Democratic regions. And the idea that these working class former Democrats who, you know, we talked about them a lot in the 19, and we, what am I saying? People talked about them a lot in the 1980s as, you know, being motivated in no small part based, or being dissatisfied with the Democratic Party in no small part because the Democrats had become the party of African Americans. This was the Reagan Democrats thesis when Stanley Greenberg goes to Macomb County outside of Detroit and sees that all these people who were once reliably Democratic think that the Democrats are now the party of welfare. It doesn't strike me as a coincidence that all these people that the Republican Party has added over the last four or five decades, who may not be ideologically consistent conservatives, but left the Democratic Party in part for racial reasons, don't have the same orthodox conservative views, would be a very strong foundation for a candidate like Donald Trump. He's resilient to attacks on racism, for controversial remarks that reason, and his unorthodox record and set of policy positions would also be less likely to offend these voters as well.
Dave, go ahead.
I see, kind of looking ahead, and this is supposed to be about November, so I want to pivot a second to say what we think is going to happen moving forward. None of this, to me, indicates that the Republican coalition will not stay together to a certain extent, enough to keep that red-blue map looking pretty similar. We only have roughly, you know, 12, 13 true swing states in this country, and none of the data that we've seen so far has really indicated to me that even if Trump, conditional on getting the nomination, would blow that map to smithereens, that there would be enough dissatisfaction in hard red states against his racism or against his more populism, which cut both ways as far as whether or not they're pro or against Republican orthodoxy, would be enough to actually flip these states into blue states. And so they're looking at somebody who is definitely, betting markets have been way below what a fundamental model looking at past election. Right now, the markets have the generic Democratic nominee at 72% or so to win the election, whereas a fundamental model looking at past elections and economic indicators would be about 50%. That is a lot about having to do with Trump and or Cruz, but still not looking at a state-by-state dramatic shift, because a lot of those coalitions will stay together and will come behind him should he be the nominee.
Can you explain a little bit about why betting markets are considered or could be considered a predictor of an outcome? What is it exactly? What is the mechanism?
So betting markets are markets with real money that allow people to go in and essentially buy contracts that canonically are worth a dollar if something happens and worth $0 if it does not happen. And these markets have been around for a while. They really take hold and do a great job at times where there's a lot of idiosyncratic information, a lot of dispersed information, because they bring in people with a lot of knowledge and they have the right question, which is what's going to happen, and they incentivize them well with the money on the line. And historically, they've done a great job in taking all that information together and providing a subjective probability that allows us to provide something that is a little more objective than normal during times in which it's pretty hard to make a model. And so during the general election, come November, Nate Silver's models with polls and Nate Cohn's models, those are going to start converging with the markets. But very early in the cycle and during primaries and on whether or not there's going to be a contested convention, they stand out as kind of the one thing in which we get all this data together and it happens on its own.
But that's because people are reading Nate Silver and Nate Cohn and then go and place their bets based on what they say.
Well, but no, there is a more subtle point here, which is something like the nomination process is very challenging to kind of model, right? And a model is just a piece of computer code, really, that kind of takes inputs and runs it through an algorithm and spits out a probability. But the combination of the fact that the nomination process is really complex structurally, for example, you have states voting one at a time instead of all at once, and so there are momentum effects, you have multi-candidate dynamics. No one that I know has really tried to build a model of the primary process. I kind of wonder sometimes if we had done that, if that would have been helpful or made us look foolish in a different way.
It would have been very under-identified.
Yeah.
Yes.
There are 20 things that you want to look at and like 12 good data points. So a model doesn't work that well. And we also are kind of now getting to a point where it kind of looked like we were coming out of the fog a little bit, where it became more of a technical problem of, well, we can look at the remaining states and will Trump get to 1237 or not. The problem now is that there's a lot of ambiguity about what happens if he's somewhere around or a little bit under 1237. How will the delegates behave? And so so we're kind of back in the fog of uncertainty again.
Well, let me pick up a little bit on this. You know, we have never had so much data available to us. We have never had so many different kinds of data available to us. We have the polls, which I want to talk about in a second. We have voter lists and voter files, and we have information on from everything from your consumer choices to, in many cases, your political choices. Why is it specifically that we still can't build this better model? Why is it that we can't fully specify a model of the process with all of this data available, or are we getting there?
I mean, one answer is, you could say kind of it's a version of chaos theory, really, where a very small perturbance in initial conditions can affect things the rest of the way. There are a lot of small things where Scott Walker, for example, talked with my dad last night about, you know, which Republican candidates dropped out, and they kind of, in general, dropped out a little bit after they maybe should have. But Scott Walker dropped out pretty early, and you have to wonder if he sometimes scratches the bald spot on his head and says, I don't know, you know, no one's doing particularly well. I might have gotten a second or a third look, whereas Rubio, one of his biggest problems, I think, ultimately was a lack of accomplishments under his name. Walker has a lot of accomplishments that are pretty impressive if you're a conservative Republican. We'd be coming into Wisconsin right now. You can imagine him doing okay in Pittsburgh and Pennsylvania. But he basically got almost no time to make his case to the people. He happened to declare his candidacy officially right when Trump declared his. Had a bad first two debates, but had a total of 6 minutes of speaking time there. So things that are fairly random, really, can profoundly affect how things happen down the road. I mean, imagine if Trump hadn't run. All these kind of things that weren't on the surface would still be there, but we wouldn't have any idea. And Trump apparently ran halfway kind of on a lark because he thought people thought he was a joke and he wanted to prove them wrong, according to the reporting. What if he hadn't run and we'd be like, oh yeah, it's coming down to Rubio and Cruz, just like in 2012, establishment versus outsider lane. And so, I don't know.
I would also just make the sharp contrast to the general election, where we have a lot more outcomes and a lot more non-correlated outcomes. So the ability to take this new data and the stuff that the Nates have done and others to predict Senate elections, state-by-state electoral college elections, that just gets better and better because we actually have identification there. Primaries, we just don't have enough outcomes.
Right. Go ahead, Nate.
You know, there's a lot of new data that could be very useful in predicting elections, and in particular, I think it holds the promise of being able to make individual-level predictions about people as we have more data from polling or from, you know, in the internet and social media potentially linked to voter registration files one day. But, you know, there are two problems. One is that most of these models are, you know, statistical and they're empirical models, right? We look at the relationship between how, you know, elections have gone and how certain variables predict it. But we don't have, you know, data about Twitter or Google searches going back for 12 elections to build a model that might incorporate Google searches or something like that. We also don't have the benefit, as you know, you do in like meteorology or something, of having the laws of nature to predict what people will do and predict them forward. The final thing, though, is that, you know, this data is not very open to the public. I mean, voter registration files cost a lot of money to access. Polling data is not publicly available in a way that would let you build individual-level predictions. Whatever things that Google or Microsoft or whatever are doing that might be useful one day for having these, you know, sort of real-time forecasts, those also aren't out there. So I'm not sure that it will be that there's a way for all of this new data to end up integrated into, you know, a coherent framework for thinking about how elections might evolve from where they are now.
Mm-hmm. You know, you said the polls for a minute, and I want to pick up on that. Obviously, the polls have formed a sort of a foundation for a lot of what we talk about and a lot of the predictions that you all make and going forward. This year, they have been pretty good. The primary polls, okay, all right, well, you know, some of them, yeah, you guys are always, you know, certainly quick if I do a poll that's off, not that that ever happens, but you know, to talk about it. But they have been pretty good this year, and why is that? Or if they haven't been good, then where have they fallen short in your mind in terms of usefulness going forward in your overall predictions, in your overall estimating of what's going to happen?
I mean, there was that one huge miss in Michigan, which is historic, in the Democratic race. But the weird thing was that it is kind of this outlier. You know, a lot of people really worried that you had Michigan the next week, you had five Midwestern states, or North Carolina's not in the Midwest, but four, depending on how you count Missouri, right? And we thought, oh, crap, you know, Ohio's going to be way off, too. And in fact, the polls were pretty accurate. So I'm kind of like, well, thank God something you can still kind of cling to a little bit. But, like, one reason why polls are useful is that polls are very simple things, right? The assumption to trust a poll is just to say, well, you know, other things being equal, what people tell me they're going to do is probably a pretty good indication of what they will actually do. And of course, there are all types of problems with like sampling that are very serious. But at least in terms of the simplicity of your hypothesis, if you like parsimony in a model, then you make very few assumptions when you have a polling based model. I know we're supposed to talk about November. You know, one thing I think a lot about as someone who has to build a November model is that if you have Trump, maybe you go even more to the extreme of having a pure polling model, right? The polls might not be great, but so for example, usually parties get a convention bounce. And in fact, we had success trying to model this convention bounce. We kind of subtract a couple of points from any polls right after the convention. If there's chaos in Cleveland, I'm not sure the GOP gets a convention bounce. It might get a convention, what's the opposite of a bounce, right?
Or the Democrats get a bounce.
Or the Democrats get a bounce. Yeah, yeah, an anti-bounce.
But wait a second. Polls aren't simple things. If anything, you could argue that polls and pollsters are becoming more sophisticated now. I mean, part of it is out of necessity, because it is with response rates dropping under 10%, it is harder and harder to do, as you know, a straight RDD, you know, probability sample. So polls are incorporating now. They're incorporating lists. They're called using, you know, RBS, registration-based sampling. They are adding likely voter models. Now, sometimes those succeed and sometimes those fail, and you've, you know, talked about that at great length. So there's, in other words, there's already a model and there's already a set of assumptions built into whatever poll you are looking at. And the consumer of the poll has to, I think if they're a good one, realize and understand what those assumptions built into it are, right? I mean,
I agree with Nate that the polling averages have been good, but I'm really troubled by some of the trends that I see in specific pollsters. I think that there are more pollsters taking shortcuts than I feel like there were. You talked about the growing number of polls using voter list samples, which is where you call people from a list of registered voters rather than randomly dialing telephone numbers. And, you know, at the beginning of the cycle, I saw the number of pollsters taking this approach and thought that was good news. I think there are a lot of reasons why that approach is more promising and also potentially more journalistically interesting as well. But a lot of pollsters are using the data on the voter registration file to target the people that are likeliest to vote, and they're missing large numbers of voters who may well participate. There are pollsters who are only calling people who have participated in two of the last three general elections. There was a survey USA poll. One anecdote before I shut up that had black voters as 13% of the North Carolina general electorate earlier this month, and that's not going to happen. It was 23% in 2012, and it was no lower than 17% in the last decade in the general election. And that's only because they don't want to spend the money to sample the entire universe of people who might participate.
Well, what is it? Heading into the primaries, what all of us were saying was primary turnout is relatively low, and it is. And we think we know something about the kind of person who is more likely to show up. And that is, in fact, the more habitual voter. So we have somebody's voting history. We have somebody's record on file, right? Why doesn't it make sense then to oversample that kind of a person? Because you're making a predictive model that somebody with a past history is going to show up. So that might not be, now to your point, that might not be the only kind of person you poll, but certainly to oversample them at least at the rate
in proportion to their likely share of the electorate. But that's not what is happening.
You're saying they're doing it because it cuts costs. Then you can get them on the phone.
Yes, it's cutting costs. And then there are some people who are really inexplicable in that they're targeting these likely voters and then adding a likely voter screen at the end. So then that you have an especially likely group of already extremely likely voters.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, the fact that we're having this conversation, I mean, there's some pollsters who are just, I'm not going to throw shade, but just are not sophisticated at all. That just suck. Although it is interesting, the candidate who has most overperformed his polls so far is Cruz, who's beaten his polls in most states. Trump, by the way, actually even to a little below. So this notion that like it's a silent majority that'll show up, it's actually like a noisy minority instead. But Cruz is someone who kind of the polls have consistently missed low on, and that might also reflect turnout. One thing that amazes me is that you would think, after all the lessons of Obama 08 and Obama 2012, where Republicans supposedly learned the importance of having a turnout operation, maybe even overlearned that lesson for the general election, these campaigns don't really have turnout operations. Cruz a little bit. Cruz has one that's maybe one quarter as good as a Democratic turnout operation, whereas everyone else has like nothing really. A few kids working in an office somewhere, and that's kind of amazing.
I heard John Kasich really was hitting the pavement in New Hampshire.
They were excited, weren't they?
They were
so happy.
They were excited. I think Cruz, though, outperforming polls is partially he has a good on the ground operation, and like when you went to Iowa, they were definitely the most organized. They have this app where like a lot of labor organizations will use door to door sort of mobile mapping things to do canvassing, and the Cruz team was ahead on that as far as, you know, no other Republican candidate really had it. But I also think Cruz has benefited from the fact that just sort of by process of elimination, he says this over and over, he's the guy who's beaten Trump. So there is a little bit of, I know at least Nate Silver hates the whole momentum thing, but the idea that Cruz has sort of been able to like present himself as this, he's sort of given himself a patina of like acceptability, which he might not have had in the magical world if Donald Trump hadn't entered. So that's also sort of, you know, there's like a slippery thing of how his identity has shifted too in this race.
But go ahead.
So it's possible that GOTV is making the difference, but it's also important to know that polls are consistently biased in the sense that on average, they should all be at the answer, but we see over time, they're consistently year after year, either biased towards the Democratic side or biased towards the Republican side. These correlations happen within states, and they're increasingly happening because coverage error and because of selection into the polls, so response rates getting worse and worse. And so polls have been doing very well, on average. But if these biases continue, at one point that bias is going to be too extreme, and RDD polling, standard traditional probability polling, will fall over. And if it doesn't happen because of this gradual slope, it's going to happen because telephone rates are just going to fall to the point where you just can't even reach a huge segment of the population. At some point, we'll be switching over to non-probability polling, and we need to be prepared for what that world looks like when it's a lot less controlled environment, where there's a lot more instability in the type of person that's doing these polls, because everyone gets a voice, and we need to do a better job in understanding the differences between the pollsters at that point.
Right. Clare, did you?
Well, I was actually going to ask you guys a question, which is, you know, my favorite thing is to always ask interview subjects, like, what's this world going to look like 5 years out, 10 years out? So for the polling world, you know, in the next election or the next two elections, how many polls are going to be done via phone? Will internet polls have taken over? And, you know, this is a question that I've asked pollsters, you know, how different will your operation look in the next few years? And I've had people say, oh, I'm not going to answer that on the record. I don't want to say. So I'm sort of curious about what you guys think sort of the future will be.
I think that we're not that far away from the point where the idea of telephone-only polls will be ludicrous, because, you know, my children may not even have a phone number. With Wi-Fi and other access, they may only have handles. The idea of reaching out to them in that way is going to be impossible. And so I think that it's a question about whether or not non-probability polling, internet-based polling, mobile-based polling, zooms past because it's faster, cheaper, and ultimately we agree that it's as accurate or more accurate for the same money, or whether or not it's simply the collapse of RDD polling. But one way or the other, we're going to be doing all of our polling on mobile devices. And so we need to prepare for what the best methodology is for that, and whether or not we, as the people who both collect it and analyze it, understand how to model that data. And there's a lot more analytics goes involved with that because the data is not as pure.
Much of the industry has already made the transition, and to some extent, political polling is sort of just catching up. But everybody should, I think, everybody should recognize the distinction between internet polling, or what they call online polling, and non-probability polling. A probability sample means everybody out there has a known probability of being selected. But what more and more folks are doing now is putting together non-probability panels or non-probability samples that, if done properly, form a little microcosm of the state or the nation, whatever it is you're trying to sample. So the mode is online, the mode is internet, but it's really, it should be considered a non-probability panel or a non-probability sample. And I agree with David. I think that's clearly the direction all of this is going. You know, I don't think it's still there yet for the pure opt-in, you know, put up a banner ad, click on this and tell me how you're voting. But, you know, that hasn't been shown to, you know, to be accurate yet.
What are the you were saying the methodologies have to be honed a little bit. I mean, can you, just for like a, for a lay audience, or, you know, what are some of those things that
yeah,
have to
I think the key thing is that right now, if you think you have a good probability sample, you actually want to stress how little analytics you put on top of it. You do as light as possible. You do this kind of light thing called raking, where you look at the general demographics of the country, and you put some weights on each person to kind of match that. In the future, you're going to look at these samples that are so biased that you need to model it, and basically take all the demographics and you run some sort of model to say what the sentiment is by demographics. And then you essentially project that onto your likely voter space, which is coming from a voter file or coming from the polling you're doing as well. But that is also a separate thing that you're modeling. And so you're modeling two things and projecting them onto it. It's a lot trickier. It's a lot more variables go into what you're doing because you're making a lot of decisions along the way. And so we're going to have a lot of trust in the brands that are doing that.
Yeah. Go ahead, Nate. And then I want to take some questions from the audience if you want to weigh in on this, and then I'll kick it out.
I mean, I expect that by 2023 or so, Emperor Trump will outlaw all polling that the Trump Organization doesn't conduct itself.
Well, that shows him with an approval rating less than 90.
But I worry a lot about not just non-probability sampling per se, but I worry a lot about this distinction David made about going from kind of just counting people to doing modeling. Because modeling is hard. And also, certain types of models, the more complicated the model, the worse it tends to fail. And by that I mean that you might have five elections in a row where it's very, very good, and then the sixth one, it's off by 10 points or something. Maybe the Michigan miss is consistent with that somehow. So we're going to have to learn a lot more about how people are doing these kind of things. There's going to be more trial and error. And I don't know. I would think that sooner or later. By the way, the last couple of midterms, the polling wasn't that great in the U.S. We've had big misses in other countries. But sooner or later, we'll have a big miss in the presidential election too, and that'll be part of the learning process. But it won't be fun for data journalists or whatever you want to call us. Because we always are in a weird place where, like, we always kind of have to root for the favorite, even though I kind of personally like chaos and surprises. But if you say something is a 70-30 outcome, even if in some sense, let's say prediction market two, maybe the conventional wisdom holds something is almost certain. You know, so for example, right now, right? I would bet the conventional wisdom has become overconfident on Trump winning relative to where prediction markets have him, right? But still, anytime the thing that's under 49% happens, then we tend to get shat on for it. So
that's a technical term.
With that, let me open it up to the audience and take some questions. I'm sure there are a bunch. Sir, in the gray jacket here in the middle. Oh, okay.
We'll do the pass down method again.
That's all right. Or just speak really loudly.
Thanks. So I wanted to ask about one kind of specific aspect of the modeling that you were just talking about. We've heard a lot about favorability. Trump obviously is quite unfavorable, but Hillary has her own set of challenges. The Post had an article yesterday based on their polling that found Trump basically unfavorable with like everyone, including white men with high school degrees. So when you guys think about your models, when you have two candidates who are unfavorable, how do you think about that? It seems pretty unprecedented, at least in modern political history.
I mean, you know, frankly, my assumption has always been that you start out with the head-to-head poll, and the head-to-head poll efficiently incorporates people's information about favorability ratings, right? So in this case, it's pretty consistent where they don't like Hillary, they really don't like Donald Trump, and Hillary's margin now seems to be fairly consistent with that. But yeah, something we're researching. People do say, I think rightly, that a Trump versus Clinton election is one where you'd have a lot of uncertainty. I mostly agree with that. On the other hand, the fact that both candidates have such strong name recognition and trigger such strong reactions is that part of me wonders, you know, maybe this is sort of baked in, especially when it cuts so cleanly across demographic lines. There aren't that many swing voters, and the fact that, the name recognition part of it more than the favorability per se might be worth looking at too.
Wait, I think this.
So one of the striking things about the process so far is how poorly candidates backed by super PACs have done, how important free media has been, especially non-traditional free media. So what role do you see of the free media in the fall campaign, and also by extension perhaps the paid media, and how is that balance going to work out? I think that for me this is one of the big surprises of the election is how the super PACs have been a complete bust.
Yeah, and I think that sort of speaks to the fact that this is a unique election in that it's sort of a bottom-up, it's not a party decides thing, right? I mean, Trump has benefited, obviously, from so much free media. Sanders has, he has PACs, he has this nurses union PAC that's giving him money, but his whole thing is small donations. I think on the Republican side, in the general election, if Trump is the nominee, it's kind of going to be, he's still going to be a draw for networks to have on. He'll do any interview, anytime. I feel like he does radio interviews in his boxers and it gets out there all the time. So I actually think from the Republicans, on his side, there's not going to be a lot of, he doesn't need that many, there's a lot of bilk about he's self-funding his campaign. He's actually not if you break it down. On the Democratic side, I think it'll be more traditional, and that'll be we've kind of, it's actually really fascinating that this primary season there hasn't been a lot of talk about super PACs. I mean, I had sort of all these stories of this is going to be really interesting, and dark money is like, that's so 2012, poor Jane Mayer, her book came out, right? So she's, I mean, the Koch brothers are obviously, they're sort of, you know, what are they, what's their new role, right? Everyone kind of has to rethink. And in some ways, I think it's not quite the Jeffersonian revolution every 4 years, probably that the man of Monticello had in mind, but there is a certain sense of everyone has to rethink it, that people, I mean, you know, we're sitting in Harvard, right? Like, we all had perceptions of what this election would be. And in some ways, you know, no matter how you feel about Donald Trump, in some ways it's sort of like, it's a little bit healthy. It's like a stress test for democracy. I think in some ways we've talked a lot about demographics, and I think one of the most interesting things is how this election is making us see people, it's slicing demographics. Let's take evangelicals, right? A lot of people thought, you know, the way Trump talks, can you believe he said these things about the Pope, blah, blah, blah. And yet he still wins evangelicals in certain states. We have these perceptions of what demographic groups are. When in fact, if you look at evangelicals, there are people, it's a slice the pie even thinner, right? There are some people who go to church every Sunday and we're probably gonna vote for Ted Cruz come hell or high water. Mm-hmm. And then there are people who think of themselves more as culturally evangelical. The way you might be culturally Jewish or culturally Catholic, you're not practicing, but you've got that sort of identity. And those people sort of tended to go more towards Trump. So I've spun off my answer to your question, but I think it's fundamentally, I think it's a fascinating election because it really is bottom up, and a lot of it is the seeds planted 5 years ago, 6 years ago by Occupy on the left and the Tea Party on the right, and those have sort of percolated, grown, whatever they've done, whatever seeds and coffee do, and they've gone up into the institutions. I mean, you know, someone, I can't remember who said it earlier today, but Marco Rubio started as a Tea Party guy, and now he's, you know, the sweaty establishment out on the sidelines. So, I mean, what are we? It's really fascinating. So that's all.
In the white T-shirt, here. Go ahead.
So you mentioned predictive markets as a kind of more reliable source of polling, more reliable source of information. And right now, my impression is that prediction markets in the U.S. are capped at fairly low amounts, dollar amounts. First of all, is that true? And then second of all, if that changed in the near future, so let's say, you know, next 4 or 8 years, polling rates go down drastically, people stop responding to phone calls from pollsters, are prediction markets going to take off? And let's say they went beyond legal. Let's say there was some technology that let them go beyond government authority. How would you forecast their growth?
So I'll give you three answers real quickly to your questions. Number one is that they are capped in the U.S., but there's markets around the world. So my work generally aggregates markets from around the world, which are not capped. But the cap is actually could be beneficial because it equalizes wealth. And in a situation where people are opting in and could possibly try to give answers that do not reflect maybe their true beliefs, but try to induce other things to happen, the fact that there's equalized wealth actually proves to help stop manipulation. The second thing is that the markets do a lot of things beyond being markets themselves. And so the reason that I've always researched them and been interested in them along with polls is because as we move into more opt-in universe, studying something in which people opt in and answer a question and aggregate in a certain method has actually taught me a lot about the methodology that I'm using in trying to study advanced analytics for opt-in polling and thinking about small groups of people. They have a lot of bias. They come in, they supplied some information. Could we be thinking about questions, incentives, and aggregation methods that actually make them sing? And then to answer the third part is if they were legal, betting on elections would be awesome. people would love it. And the analogy I always like to draw to is you think about something like a fantasy football where you have people who moved from just following their regional team to spending 12 hours a weekend watching every single game. You can argue whether or not it's healthy or not, but if people had money on the line, they would be doing the same thing for politics, and maybe it would induce some positive changes in our democracy.
Right, but just to
move. I'm told I have time for one more question. The gentleman in the... Yeah, go ahead, sir, with the blue jacket. Quickly, if you could.
Hello, thank you.
Yes.
I'm just wondering if Bernie tomorrow announced that... Elizabeth Warren is going to back him, and that he'll be she'll be his running mate, what would that do to the situation?
I mean,
you just want us to idly speculate.
Claire looks like she has a ready answer.
I don't know if I have an answer for that. I think it would never happen. But it's a nice thought exercise. I think it would still not do anything for his campaign. We've talked about this. Harry Enten is sitting here front row center, who's sort of very smartly, and Nate too, have sort of been beating the math drum.
Harry is the one who all the Bernie fans are not fond of.
Yeah. but there are, I probably have the lowest math SAT score of the people up here on the stage, but math kind of doesn't lie to a certain extent in this situation, which is that even if he had a wonderful, you know, there's only so much that a passion play can do, which is what Elizabeth Warren would be. I think that, you know, Clinton has these superdelegates, and while it would give, in some ways, I think it might actually be damaging. You know, once Clinton actually wins the nomination, then you will have entrenched the Bernie supporters even more on the other side, and they might not want to turn out, you know, come election day, which would be bad news bears if you're, a Democratic Party faithful. So I don't know. I mean, I think it's a bit of a, while I think a lot of people, you know, because Sanders the other day said something, you know, he wasn't sure if he was going to go out and campaign for whoever becomes the eventual nominee. Now I kind of, you know, maybe he was just a little salty on that day, or maybe, you know, he's a guy who wasn't in the mainstream, you know, wasn't in the Democratic Party mainstream, obviously. So I don't know. Does anyone else have a...
I mean, I think there's been this kind of question, well, given how well Bernie is doing, doesn't that mean Elizabeth Warren would be doing better? And I'm not totally sure, in part because Bernie, in his own way, and it should not be categorized the same way with Trump, but, like, you know, it's been a little bit improbable, too, both in the literal sense, but also in the sense, I think, part of Bernie's appeal is that he's kind of an un-politician, and it's kind of a hip thing to be for Bernie because he's clean and pure, right? And birds land on his podium when he's giving a speech, and that he's not, quote unquote, a typical politician. So look, I think the Bernie thing is going to have a lot of implications for the future, and to Claire's point earlier, you know, maybe we should have been paying more attention. A lot of attention was paid, but even more to the Tea Party, to Occupy Wall Street. You know, by extension, maybe now we should be paying a lot of attention to Black Lives Matter and what that means, paying a lot of attention to the Bernie Sanders campaign and what that means. Even the people who, like on this panel, our whole claim is that, oh, we're always giving you perspective and we slow you down from the news cycle. You know, we can be pretty myopic about looking at what's going to happen this year and not thinking about what this means for 4, 8, 12 years down the road.
And so with that, let me thank you all for paying attention to this not typical but wonderful and extraordinary panel. Thank you. Nate Silver, Nate Cohn, Rothschild, Claire Malone.